Rail Yard, and I just want to say thank you again to SFI, to Caitlin McShay, David Krakauer, Kayla, and the entire SFI team. Tim, you guys have just been tremendous in putting on a very ambitious project for the first time, and we hope it's a long and glorious relationship with the Rail Yard. We love having you here. I also want to make sure those of you who are here just for the Interplanetary event this morning that you know what else is going on. This is a wonderful collaboration also with Currents New Media. They're putting their final touches on as we speak inside the El Museo Hall right down here and across the tracks. If you've never been to Currents New Media, I promise you, you're in for a mind-blowing treat. So please go tonight. They open at 6. They're open till midnight. We'll have a fabulous concert here tonight with Max Cooper on the main stage, brought to us by Meow Wolf. Thank you, Meow Wolf. And the conjunction of these two events happening at the same time in Little Santa Fe, New Mexico, is nothing short of extraordinary. So please go see world-class media art of all kinds from all over the world tonight inside El Museo. What else, Caitlin?
Currents is the official Interplanetary.
Currents is the official after party for Interplanetary. So there you go. You have to go. Okay? And I'm going to turn over the day's events to DA, who's going to tell you everything that's going to happen.
Thank you very much. Welcome, everyone. We're going to get right into it because we're running a few minutes late, and I don't want to take time away from this extraordinary panel. I'll just give you a couple words about each of the panelists. Chaim Benaroya is a professor at Rutgers University in the Department of Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering, and he focuses on structures that are capable of enduring extreme environments, of which space is obviously a great example. Nina is a staff scientist at Los Alamos. She told me the other night about her favorite gemstones, which were labradorite and tanzanite, only found in Tanzania. And she works on the history of water on Mars, focuses on manganese in the Martian environment. So get ready. Brian Ferguson, who I've known for a couple years, was a Navy SEAL and now coaches all sorts of organizations on high performance. And finally, we have a multiple-time Olympian, Ashton Eaton here, who has the world record in the decathlon. I need to say no more. With that, give it up for the panelists. Thanks.
Got mics? There we go. Good morning. All right. Thank you guys for your patience. This is, I think, is almost a tease. You see the panelists I'm super humbled to be up here with, and we're going to talk about the idea of living in space. What does that entail? What goes into planning? But we could easily spend 30 minutes just on the bios of each of the folks up here. So we're gonna keep it focused this morning as best as possible and talk first about the austere environment of space, and then get into the mental and the emotional components that come with living in an environment beyond Earth, and then close maybe with some day-to-day thoughts on what it would be like to live in space. But one of the things I think that inevitably when you have these conversations, we get really excited about the novelty. You know, as kids, the idea of traveling or living in space is sexy and exciting, but we don't think about two things. One, the practicality, but more important, the deeper human element of why we do that. And I thought it would be appropriate to start with a quote from Chaim Benaroya, who's up here. And so Dr. Benaroya obviously has spent his life thinking about living in an austere environment and building structures, but I love this quote, and I just want to share it as a place to start. A love of the possibilities of space exploration and settlement, initially on the moon, but eventually on Mars and into the solar system, is born of the positive vision it engenders for humanity. Space opens up a universe of possibilities. It creates new options for how people will view their lives and those of their descendants. But equally important and hopeful, space also opens up avenues for improving life here on Earth and all of its inhabitants. The engineering of space travel and lunar habitats creates technologies that can improve life here on Earth. By learning how to create safe and happy environments for humans in the unforgiving space environment, we also increase our understanding of healthful and productive lives here on Earth. So just, I think, a really cool way to frame the importance of this conversation. This is not just about the esoteric world of space, but about our lives here, and obviously some people who are extraordinarily accomplished. So I'm gonna do hopefully the least amount of talking this morning, but was mentioned my passion. I actually was privileged to meet SFI a few years ago and went through their summer course and just became entranced with what SFI is doing in the realm of complexity and bringing extraordinary people together. But I've spent my life in the world of human performance and was privileged to serve in special operations, where it was constantly about how do we think about succeeding and training for austere environments. But I want to start, we'll move through some introductions here and then jump in. And maybe we'll start with Dr. Nina Lanza, who's just up the road at the laboratory, but has had an extraordinary life herself thinking about Mars and life beyond Earth. So Nina, why don't you go ahead and open up with a brief introduction?
Sure. Yeah. So I am a planetary scientist at Los Alamos National Laboratory. And what that basically means is I study rocks on other planets, specifically Mars. And I'm working on the Curiosity rover mission on an instrument called ChemCam that is operating right now on Mars as we speak. And you may have heard, actually, our team came up with, we had some really big results yesterday from Mars. We found there is...
And real quick, let me interrupt you. How many people saw the news yesterday? Awesome. So it's almost like they planted a story for this panel. But go ahead and explain what happened.
Sure. Well, amongst other things, one of the biggest, most exciting discoveries that we've made is that there is methane currently in the atmosphere on Mars. And it's not just there constantly. It's actually little puffs of methane that appear to be seasonal. And why that's really exciting, several reasons. One is that methane on Earth only comes from two primary sources. You know, so it comes from volcanoes, but it also comes from life. We and cows make a lot of methane. So that's a big reason we have methane in our atmosphere. But methane does not last very long. It lasts in the order of 100 years. It breaks down. So when we see methane in the atmosphere of Mars, we know it has to be being made now. Now, we don't know what the source of this methane is, but we know something right now on Mars is making it. And so there are two options, right? So it could be that there is some kind of chemistry, and we know there are chemistries that can do this, that is making methane, coming out through cracks and just seasonally releasing it, right? But it also opens up the possibility of microbes. Now, don't say you heard it from me that there's life on Mars, right? We're still working that out. But it really tells us this is a really important piece, this is an important observation for us to track down because of its implications. At the very least, Mars is a lot more active than we thought it was. So stay tuned, because we're still driving around Mars. We're doing this right now, so there'll be many more results, and we're going to be trying to track this down. So that's my day job. But the reason I'm here is because I've actually spent time in Antarctica searching for meteorites on the ice as part of the Antarctic Search for Meteorite Project. And so we spend 2 months in Antarctica, living in tents, on the ice, pretty much equidistant between Pole Station and McMurdo, trying to find meteorites. And it's a very similar experience to long-duration spaceflight, so much so that NASA funds a human factor study on all of us in the field to try to figure out how we tick and what makes teams work and what makes teams not work. And so I've had the pleasure of spending time in the field learning about what it's like to work in these extreme environments. And I think it was very surprising. So we'll talk more about that.
Awesome. Thank you. And I love Nina's bio. If any of you went in and read, I think if you were to ask me as a kid, or you ask some young kids who are excited about space, what is it you want to do? They'd say something like, I want to work on a spaceship, and I want to use lasers and go to Mars. And Nina's bio says, I'm currently living my dream, working on a spaceship using lasers on Mars. So pretty badass.
Yeah, right. Greatest job ever, right?
Yeah. So I want to go down. We'll skip to the end here, over to Ashton. And why don't you go ahead and talk about your background?
Sure. So I retired from the sport of track and field about 2 years ago. And essentially, I got into university on a sports scholarship to do this thing called the decathlon. And getting to college was like my first major goal in life, because my family had really never been. And so being the first one was important. And once I got there, I just got fascinated with this challenge of physical performance, because my kind of guiding question my whole life was, what am I capable of? And decathlon really let me push the limits to try to figure that out. And so essentially for a decade, I pursued it as far as I could. Went to a couple of Olympics and did the whole world record thing. But around 2014, so in between the 2012 and 2016 Olympic Games, I had won 2012, and I was kind of thinking, I don't really know if going to 2016 makes sense. Like, I think there's other ways to contribute. And so I started reading a ton of books, and I'd always been interested in space travel. I wanted to be a pilot when I was younger. And I came across a book by Nikola Tesla, and he kind of opened up my eyes to different ways to contribute. And then I kind of went down this rabbit hole of philosophers and scientists. And I was thinking, this is what I want to do after I'm done with sport. And I was thinking, well, space travel is important, but what about terrestrially? Like, you know, there's certain things that need to happen here. And I just kind of came to the conclusion that being out among the stars, we have a better chance of kind of, you just seek greater understanding and maybe understand our place. And also, it's like really exciting and inspiring. So I'm here because I listened to a podcast that David was talking to Sam Harris, who's a philosopher. And he was talking about complexity and all these different things that I kind of abstractly had in my mind. I have these notebooks filled of systems theory, and I was reading all these systems theory books. And I was like, there's a place that literally just thinks and studies this stuff. So I called David, and I was like, who are you and what are you doing? And we had a conversation, and he said there's this conference about living in space. And so I said, I had to be there. And yeah, I'll be able to talk maybe about the human performance side of things and the mentality and a little bit of the physicality it takes to push your body to the limit, knowing that I believe I did it fairly well the last decade.
Yeah, and that's an important point. You can hear that Ashton obviously is humble in how he presents himself, but I want to contextualize this and why it's important when we talk about living in space. So the NCAA, the National Collegiate Athletic Association, does these statistics on what your probability of becoming a professional athlete is. So to become, if you play football in college, to become a professional athlete, your chances are 0.3%. And in the NBA, you're looking at 0.02. To become an Olympian, 0.001% of people who play a sport actually become an Olympian. And not only was Ashton an Olympian, he won 2 gold medals and set a world record. And in that, what is fascinating is what is the mindset and how do you think about, because on one hand, there's the training, but we know there's far more on the mental side of pushing limits and training for something so specific. We start talking about living in space, there's a whole nother level of commitment that's required. So Ashton has a lot of interesting insights. Now we'll sort of open up the our final introduction with Dr. Benaroya here. So Chaim, you want to go ahead and talk about your life studies here?
So it's great to be here. I'm really honored to be with three super accomplished people on the stage. So my background is more along the engineering lines. I got passionate about space as a young person, reading science fiction like many people did and watching some of these movies. And I thought, how, as an engineer interested in structures, could I make a contribution to this adventure we call space exploration, space settlement? And I thought, well, thinking about how do we build structures on a place like the moon and make it habitable to people so they could live happy lives. And as I read more and more about it and studied it more, I started to see that whereas on Earth, a structural engineer doesn't have to worry about a lot of things other than building the structure, because the air is there, the sunlight is there, there are pipes for water, there's electrical conduits. On the moon, we're basically creating a whole new civilization. And so building a structure on the moon means having people have happy lives there. If you look at this stage and you basically make it about a quarter of the size that it is, that'll be the size of our first lunar structure. It's not a lot of space for maybe half a dozen people. So some of the issues that we have to deal with as engineers designing structures is also dealing with how do we make that structure such that people will survive the extremes of the temperatures on the lunar surface, the radiation effects. If you're claustrophobic, a lunar base is not for you. I know I'm a little bit claustrophobic. I don't think I could really live in a lunar base. It has to be a much bigger lunar base, let's put it that way. So there are a lot of issues that we have to deal with that are really beyond engineering, the physiological issues, the psychological issues, and I guess that's what makes it really exciting. One of the things that we cannot test on Earth is the low gravity effects. We can do everything else on Earth as far as testing the structure against the radiation, the temperatures, and those kind of things, but the low gravity on the moon, we have 1/6 Earth gravity, which means that if you can jump up 5 feet here on Earth, then you can jump 30 feet on the moon, so that's pretty extraordinary. And
Sign me up,
right? So the question is, what happens to the human body? We know a lot of negative things happen to the human body in a low-gravity environment, and we're starting to learn that. But the long-term gravity effects on the moon means that we have to live on the moon long-term and start figuring things out. So I think structural engineering, for space is really, it's everything engineering. And so it's a really exciting adventure.
Fantastic. And then for those who are interested, HIMES runs the Center for Extreme Environments, is that correct?
Right. So it's a center of people that, that deal with these kind of issues. And also, in case you're interested, I think at 2:15, I have a more detailed talk about lunar bases and stuff. So hopefully I'll see some of you there as
and
well.
And I think later today he'll be signing. He's also got a book out on building structures on the moon. So
right,
he'll be signing a book later today, too.
That's right. Later this afternoon.
So let's dive in. And I want to keep this organic, but maybe we'll start, I think, with what we call the austere environment. Because, again, there's when we think about space here on Earth, we forget about how unforgiving space itself can be. And I think maybe a good place to start is with Nina, who, as you heard her mention, actually lived in Antarctica in a very extreme environment. And so maybe just talk a little bit about what you learned and what surprised you the most.
Sure, yeah. So Antarctica, as you may be aware, is a continent. It's on the South Pole, right? So it's entirely glaciated. So it's covered in ice, but it's the driest place in the world. So it's a desert because it's very cold there, turns out. I can verify this. But one of the things that's so what was special about the project that I was on is we are living literally in tents, canvas tents, on the ice. And there's only 8 people there, and that's the only 8 people you're going to see for 6 weeks. And Antarctica is a strange place because nothing lives there. We were the only living creatures. You know, you see, okay, there are penguins, right? Those are the margins, right? And let's forget March of the Penguins, right? They are mostly not in the interior. The interior is so stark. There are no plants. There are no animals. And there's no sound but the wind and the cracking of ice. And that, over time, is so alien. It makes you feel incredibly small. You realize that Antarctica doesn't care about you, right? A lot of people have died in Antarctica. We think, oh, we have all this technology. It's easy now. You know, and the great explorers 100 years ago, you know, Shackleton, Scott, Amundsen, they all thought that we would have conquered Antarctica by now. They had this vision that there would be daily flights to the pole and people would live there. That's not true. It's still Shackleton's country. It's still desolate and barren and a hard place to live, even with all of our technology. And so for me, one of the greatest surprises is just I didn't realize how much stimulation and how beautiful, you know, our Earth is. We get so much stimulation just being here. Look at the sky is blue, the trees are green, I hear all these people, there's a very gentle breeze. None of that is in Antarctica. And I realized, I started feeling starved for things like smell. There's no smell in Antarctica. You try, right? It's very fresh air, but you can't smell anything. We're so used to being able to smell different things. Even ourselves, right? You can barely smell anything. I really missed darkness. I was there during the austral summer. The sun never set. And it was so surprising how much I missed that. The sun kind of got lower in the sky, bounced down, so you had longer and shorter shadows. But that darkness is very comforting in many ways, and I really missed that.
Can you talk about the loneliness element, how you guys overcame that as a team? I think that's really compelling.
Yeah, sure. So you are really isolated, right? You're with a team of people that you're not related to and that you may not have met before. I had only met one of the people previously, and so here we are living. We each live in a tent by two, so there's an 8-foot by 8-foot tent that you share with somebody that you just met. You get to know each other really well. But one of the things that we did every evening after we came back from our field work, we would gather in our communal tent, which was also only 8 feet by 8 feet, so we're very close together. And we would read to each other. We would read from the journals of Scott and Amundsen. So those are the two great polar explorers who eventually got to the South Pole first. And of course, Scott got there 5 weeks after Amundsen and then didn't make it back. So we can read day by day. On the day that we are in Antarctica, we read from both of their journals. Where were they today? What were they thinking? What were they feeling? And it was so remarkable to hear, I feel like, my feelings on the page. And not only that, to share that with the team. You know, this was our opportunity to speak to one another. We did it every night. Doesn't matter how tired you are, we all gathered together and connected because I think, we were all the living creatures there were out there. And we had to support each other. We needed each other literally to live.
And that's powerful. We were talking earlier about, again, if we get together here and go to space, how do we stay inspired and motivated in these in an extreme environment, draw energy? And that ends up being from community and rooting it in our senses. And so I want to go back. Ashton made a really powerful comment about his Olympic quest and connection to senses for inspiration. Do you mind sharing that?
So in 2015, it was the World Championships, year before the Olympic Games, and the World Championships were in China. Never been to China before, and I was there for a week or two beforehand, just getting prepared for the competition, and it was extremely foreign to me. Like, the food wasn't, you know, the best. It was just like living in a hotel, and I was feeling just completely down, like I didn't want to be there. It was kind of the first time during my career where I didn't want to be somewhere. And the morning of the competition, I go out of the hotel to do my warm-up, and there's pine trees. And where I grew up in Central Oregon is just full of pine trees. And I went up to a tree, and I smelt this bark, and instantly my entire mood was changed. I actually took a piece of that bark and put it in my pocket and kept it with me during the competition. And there was just something about the mental trigger that it triggered. It kind of reminded me why I was doing this. First, it reminded me where I came from, and then it reminded me why I was doing this. I think it was for home, to inspire the people where I grew up. And I ended up breaking the world record at that competition because of that. And I know for a fact that it wouldn't have been the case. And so it was that lesson just taught me how powerful it was. And actually, I worked with Nike leading into the Olympics. I told them this story, and they created these vials full of all these things from my hometown. So they filled it with pine tree needles, with juniper oil, with lava rock, so I could like grab and feel just, you know, semblances of home when I'm in a foreign land.
So if anyone's looking for business ideas here on space exploration, it sounds like olfactory smells and vials.
Yeah. You're talking a lot about feel, you know, how all these things make you feel, and then how you are reacting to that.
I think we undervalue scent as something that can really change our mood in our lives. I think none of us likes a bad smell, right? We all like good smells, but we don't realize how many smells are all around us. You know, we can smell so many things right now, and that is part of what makes us feel like we are at home.
Right.
And so, as you said, you know, your town smells a certain way, and when you can smell those things, suddenly you know that you're in the right place.
Yeah.
If you lack that, right, if you were, you know, whether in China or in a space station, you know, that actually has a huge effect on your ability to do your work.
Right. Well, actually, one question I had for you was, you were there 6 to 8 weeks. If you were to go back now, how much longer could you stay, knowing what to expect?
Oh, goodness. I think I could do a lot better. I wouldn't want to go maybe for an entire year. Those people are hardcore. I'm not ready for that yet. But if I were to go and do Ansmet again, if I were going to go longer, you know, I think with having a bunch of scent vials plus the sounds of the earth, you know, like rainstorms, I could definitely go for many more weeks. I bet I could do like 3 months and still feel human.
Well, I think this is like an important point. Once we experience something novel, I think when we go back to do it again, we kind of have that expectation. There's a preparation phase where it's like, okay, here's the things I did wrong and right that contribute to success. Mm-hmm. Then you may, you know, maybe be able to extend that. Yeah. So kind of to your point of living in space for a long time.
Yeah, re-baselining.
And that's one of the challenges of going to a lunar base for the first time is we have really no such experience. And the other thing is how do we team the people? Even though the astronauts won't all know each other, they don't know each other in that environment. And so the perceptions and how they react with each other will change with time. So that's a real challenge.
And the teaming, I really want to dive into this. And right before we do, Chaim, I'd be curious to hear from you. What do you think it is? What's the biggest thing that most people don't consider when talking about living in space for an extended period of time? There's short trips out and back. But what is it in someone who's studied building structures to protect from that environment?
Right, so I think people don't realize, first of all, the very close quarters I mentioned earlier. The other thing is that there is no outside, really, in the sense that you can go out for a walk. I mean, you can go outside with a spacesuit, but you're still in something. So the lunar surface, you don't have all these colors, you don't have any noises. However, on the inside of the structure, there's a lot of noises. There's machine noises, low frequency rumbles. There's all kinds of things happening that affect your hearing. So I think that people don't realize that you really are in a very small capsule, really, forever. Until eventually we talk about larger bases. We're talking about inflatable structures that can be huge. But we're not talking about that initially. So we're talking about probably maybe 10, 20 years in these very small quarters until we're able to build an infrastructure and have larger bases there.
You said earlier, can you say one more time what size space we'd be talking about, physical space?
Right. So if you want to imagine, take one of those tents, that would be the first lunar base, the area under one of those tents. And that includes not just people with beds. It includes machines. It includes places where you eat, places where you shower. And that's maybe for half a dozen people.
So all our recruits will come from San Francisco.
Yeah.
Plenty of experience. Right. I live in San Francisco now, so it's like basically the same thing.
I remember
exactly.
The PI, the principal investigator of the Antarctic project that I'm on, actually put it really well. He's like, you know, this experience of living in this small space is something that most of us do not ever do except with like a spouse-like partner, right? That we share with like maybe like one-ish person, you know. One person can have that space with it, but you're going to have to do that with more people and people that you're not, you know, in any, you know, you're not married to or otherwise partnered with. Maybe people that you don't, you know, like all that much. You know, hopefully the first settlers will be a really tight team, but as we start building, right, you're not going to love everybody who lives in your lunar settlement.
Right.
So how do you deal with that in these quarters the size of that tent?
And we're unfortunately down to a few minutes here. And I think something that's compelling, particularly given the experience on the stage, is dive a little bit on teams. I will say, when we leave, grab these guys throughout the day. There's a whole bunch of things we didn't even get to touch on. One that I find is fascinating that everyone's been involved in is how do we build equipment for extreme environments? And so Ashton's coming at it from someone who designed for extreme sports at Nike, tools and equipment to amplify an athlete. And then we've got Nina working on the rover. And Haim, who spent a career thinking about structures, which is a whole fascinating conversation. But on the teams front, mm-hmm. Back to you, Ashton, when you think about it, because if we're going to live in a tent that size for any extended period of time, you can't walk away if you have a falling out with one of your teammates. So what is it that you think about in the world of coming from as an Olympian on high-performing teams that matters most?
Communication. This is something I actually didn't do very well at all. That my coach and my wife taught me. My wife is also an Olympian, and we train together. And I think the source of a lot of, maybe all conflict, if at its very base level, is misunderstanding. And so communication, to be able to say, Haim, I understand or know to a certain degree where you are coming from, and for Haim to say, Ashton, I know where you are coming from, to have some sort of mutual understanding is like unbelievably massive.
Yeah.
And it's you actually can't articulate it into words. If you have a great relationship with somebody, it's most likely at the basis communication. And something I want to touch on outside of that is, and I think Nina was kind of bringing it up, when you're going to go to these new environments, and they will be new initially, the gear and the things that you do, I don't know, you probably journaled, I'm not sure, the information that you bring back is like absolutely vital. I think there has to be a gear or component to the things that we make that captures the information about living that environment. Because there'll be a lot of unconscious and things hard to articulate in our mind, but if we can somehow have the environment help us gather that data to bring it back, I think that's very vital to the next group.
Go ahead.
Well, I just think that is really what we're going to need to do. Like, it's very hard to predict how you're going to feel, and the only way to figure that out is to put yourself into these extreme environments, which is why I think we can come up with all, we can theorize all we want, you know, but we are going to have to live in extreme environments in order to learn how to live in extreme environments.
Yep.
On the team's front, what was your most profound insight, even though it was for a shorter period of time, living with the team in Antarctica?
Well, I mean, I think I have to agree. I mean, this everyone says communication, but that's absolutely the case, you know. So my tent mate, again, living in this tiny little tent, she really needed her space in the morning, but 8 feet by 8 feet is not a lot of space. And so the way that we negotiated, she said, look, can we just, let's not talk in the morning. She had headphones in, listening to some music. She had our hoodie up, so she couldn't even see me. It's not that she hates me. We actually are great friends. We are wonderful friends. But she needed her space. She needed to feel like she was alone in the morning. And you can't be alone in Antarctica. It's not safe, right? So she expressed this to me. And I was like, well, I was really glad she told me. And so I think being able to ask for what you need, honestly, and being able to accept, you know, help other people meet their needs, both that sort of give and take is key. It's so important. Because otherwise, I mean, seriously, this is why people kill each other in these tiny spaces, right? You know, if you don't, if you aren't giving people, if their needs aren't met and your needs aren't met, this is an unhappy team, and you're not going to be able to accomplish what you're both there to do.
Right.
So, Haim, when do you think we might actually have a structure, livable structure beyond Earth, when if you're putting an over-under on a date?
Yeah, so I would say politics governs everything, it seems. So I would say if the politics is right, we could really be on the moon with a capsule in about 10 years. And then once we're there, then I think within 10 years after that, we can have much larger structures. And from there, we can build the infrastructure and understanding we would need to be able to go to Mars and perhaps other things that we're talking about that are very exciting.
Right. So 10 years, you heard it here first. Who's interested in going? About half, maybe 10 people. All right, we'll talk after. So I want to thank you guys for your time. I recognize we just scratched the surface. I think everyone, all three are going to be around all day. There's a lot of compelling questions and conversation we get to. But it's a privilege, and I'm humbled to be up here with all of you. So thank you guys, and thanks to FSSFI.
Thanks for coming out.
Thanks. Great.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back. Day two, Santa Fe Institute's first annual interplanetary festival. Thank you for coming for that early panel, which proved to be extremely interesting. Obviously, more activities to come. But for now, an opportunity to enjoy. We would like to welcome onto the stage Michael Garfield, paleontologist turned futurist, host of the Future Fossils podcast. I recommend that you all subscribe. There's actually a couple of episodes recently featuring interplanetary scientists from SFI. And all of these beautiful songs you were about to hear are scientistic themselves. Would you like me to say anything else?
No, you're good. Thank you.
Enjoy!
Hey, everyone. So, obviously, we live in an age of exponential change. And as Stuart Brand said in The Clock of the Long Now, that when progress comes too fast, people experience it as change. They try to hide from it. They try to make it go away. So this song is about living in a metamorphic age, an age of future shock and constant transformation. And it goes out to every one of you because we're all in this together. Everything that goes away really, it only ever changes shape. Innumerable masks and shades peeling off your only lover's face. The grave that overcomes the lace. Everything has been exchanged, healing, but gone and all that still remains. Thank you. even if you die. No flood can wash away the sky. And in the cold and mud, we're left asking why. But love can only answer I. Thanks. Much like the planet Earth, off to a rocky start. Yeah, it's hard to read the tuner up here, but that's okay. This I went to school for evolutionary biology, and the deeper I got into the study of it, the more I was compelled, obsessed by this idea that there was no life before there was life. That suddenly there was, and it didn't make any sense. And I found the work of Dave Diemer and Terrence Deacon at UCSC talking about this process called autocatalysis, whereby one enzyme creates the other enzyme, and then together they create each other, and it's a runaway chain reaction. And that all you need to do maybe is get a little wet-dry cycle in there, or a bolt of lightning or something, and that all the parts are there, all the processes are in place. And then 2 + 2 = 5, you know? That's emergence, and that's the sort of gist of this thing here. Thank you. And then there's life. And it just happens. Oh, so, you know, they've got the new Jurassic Park film coming out in a couple days. Do not cheer for this. They, I have a real hard time with the translations to film, especially recently, where it seems like they're just, you know, the first movie was about resurrecting dinosaurs, and then the last two movies were about resurrecting the first movie, you know, which obviously they lost some of its DNA along the way. But I still think that, you know, 27 years on or whatever it's been since the first Jurassic Park book came out, that we're in a really weird time. We're at a time where science fiction is becoming science fact, where we have to behave as if magicians because our will becomes material faster than it ever has. And that's an enormous responsibility on each of us to be mindful about what it is that we want. So this is a song about that, couched in the language and actually lifting directly out of the dialogue of Jurassic Park. It's called Life Finds a Way. Forgotten ages, switching given sexes, through electric fences, long extinct but here, smarter than you fear, dodging categories, towering for stories, life breaks free. Life expands to new territories, painfully and even dangerously. Life. Climbing out of minds into books and films and toys and rhymes, shaping generations realer than imagination, fiction true as fact, chicken teeth are. So be careful what you wish for. Hope you wanna die by dinosaur. Life breaks free. Life expands to new territories. Pain. Life finds a way. Oh, 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 oh. Thanks. You know, they say that clapping came out of the... We used to believe that the spirit entered someone during a performance, and that after the performance, you had to dispel the possession. That, you know, you had to get rid of the genius that inhabited the artist. So you clap to scare away the ghost, you know? So anyway, I just, you know, it's funny how all of these little superstitions remain embedded in our ostensibly modern rational age, you know. Speaking of modern age, here's a song about the neurophysiology of the near-death experience. And every moment is a little near-death experience, right? Like, that moment of choice is the moment where the person you were dies and the new one is born. And that's why decision is such a difficult thing sometimes. And this is a song called Indecision. Second before acting lines, a void where every future gleams, reflecting every other, every moment, a uniquely blooming world. And in the space between two thoughts, where every other instant pours, expanding now into infinity, and every possibility unfurls. How do you choose? How do you choose? Oh, how do you choose your next life? It may seem your heart has stopped. Between two beats, it's not the universe that ended, but the jaw already dead. Remembering everything it wants, seeing past the limits of your head. Seconds it would take to drain the oxygen from your exquisite brain. A few mere seconds, all your life replays an intimate refrain. It isn't just the fireworks of dying neurons firing. You are slipping from the grip of that which kept you in the slow procession. Now your feathered eyelids open to behold the whole terrain. So how do you choose? Oh, how on earth do you choose? Do you choose your next life? 'Cause it may seem your heart has stopped between two beats. It's not the universe that ended, but the jaw already dim. Remembering everything it wants, seeing past the limits of your head. Thanks. I'm running on kind of a short thing here, so I'm gonna do two more for you. And this next one is a song that I first played as a beta tester for Google Glass in 2013, and I took my own point of view from the head-mounted camera, and I projected it on stage so that the audience could see themselves behind me, which is a very disturbing and uncanny experience. It's what my friend author Rachel Nagelberg calls breaking the fifth wall. Not the wall between the stage and the audience, but the wall between the theater of your life and your own witnessing awareness to see yourself from the outside. We know that we can induce out-of-body experiences with virtual reality if we just put a camera behind somebody's head and let them look at themselves from behind. And we're all getting sort of vaunted into this space now, you know, with the way that our senses have extended into this global web of sensors. But it's not a horrible thing, really, as long as we're all together in it, like they were Nina was talking about on the Antarctica base. You know, there are things that we can do for one another to make the singularity less awful. And that's what this is.
born sharing it.
Yet. So my new friend Marcy and I were talking yesterday about how the accelerating pace of change is what brought about the recent boon in interest in corporate workplace mindfulness. You know, that it's like, it's getting harder and harder to like not lose a finger on the job, as it were. You know, in an age of what Douglas Rushkoff called present shock, where everything happens at once, that we're living in a world where the relevant details of our lives are happening faster than our ability to observe them. And on some level, it's sort of the internet has sort of induced a global psychedelic experience in which the ego has no place anymore. We simply don't have the RAM to devote to this nonsense anymore in order to stay afloat. And so this is a song about the phenomenology of awakening, which neurophysiologists would call a disactivation of the default mode network, in case you care to follow up on that particular line of research. It's a fantastic blog called Happiness Beyond Thought, authored by Penn State Emeritus Professor Gary Weber. But anyway, here you go. Thanks so much, Mo, for listening. This is the Fractals of Jonathan Wolff on stage behind me. I want to give a huge, huge thanks to Caitlin and everyone else at SFI for having me. And you can find all of my music online at michaelgarfield.net or anywhere you happen to be listening to music. I'm digitally promiscuous. Enjoy, everybody. Mulligan. I have no hard copies for sale, no. But it's all free online, and like, or pay whatever you want. You go to Bandcamp. And I don't know. It's Jonathan Wolff is the Fractal Foundation in Albuquerque. Here, he has a booth. Mm-hmm. I'm falling out of these open eyes. Challenging all my ideas of size. What was once narrow feels miles wide. All of a sudden and all of time, there's one thing I know, yes, that angels appear when you're not trying to prove them. And the clouds clear, you don't have to move. Falling out of these open eyes, filling up all of the rail outside. 'Cause I'm seeing more than fits in my eye, spilling the bliss out through bright surprise. There's one thing I know, yes, that angels appear when you're not trying to prove them. And the clouds clear, you don't have to know. Okay, thanks everybody. Actual end of show. I'll be up later doing live notes for some of the panels. Stick around, it's a beautiful thing. And thanks everybody so much.
All right, moving right along. We are now going to witness a discussion about the origins of life, and we couldn't have better participants. Chris Kempis, currently at the Santa Fe Institute, is an astrobiologist and physicist, very interested in the origins of life. And Chris, prior to SFI, spent time at NASA Ames and Caltech. He has a PhD in physical biology from MIT. And across from him, Caleb Scharf joins us from New York City, where he is at Columbia University. And also in New York, he is the co-founder of Y House, a new institute devoted to uncovering the mysteries of consciousness. But when he's not focused on consciousness, he focuses on astrobiology, physics, and the origins of life as well. So with that, I will turn it over to them, and you're in for a treat.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, dear.
So we're going to talk about the origins of life in space, but what does that mean?
Yeah, so by life in space, we don't mean the life that we put in space. We mean homegrown, naturally occurring, free-range life that has self-organized itself on some planet. So this is a question that's intimately connected with astrobiology. In order to understand where there might be life in the universe, we have to first understand how life gets started. So in thinking about astrobiology, one of the main organizing principles for the last, 40 years, has been this idea of the Drake equation, which is just a way to put together all the different probabilities that go into the likelihood of finding life in the universe. I wanted to ask Caleb what you think are sort of the hardest parts or most unlikely probabilities in that Drake equation, and which things you think we understand really well and where there's a lot of room to discover more.
Yeah, and just to add as well to this topic that we're talking about, I think part of the motivation, because sometimes people say, well, what do we care about life elsewhere? Sure, it would be cool to know. But ultimately, it's about finding context for ourselves. And the Drake equation was sort of at the forefront of that. Frank Drake, an astronomer, came up with this back in 1961. So I'll just explain that a little bit, and we'll talk about the pieces we know something about and the pieces we are entirely ignorant about, but we're hoping to make progress on. So the idea of the Drake equation is really, the bottom line of it, it's quite a specific thing. It's about estimating how many communicative species are out there in our galaxy. Now, it's not a first principles equation. It's not a predictive equation because we have no idea how to write an equation like that, which I think is something we'll talk a little bit more about. So the Drake equation is a set of factors that if you multiply them all together, gives an estimate for how many communicative species there could be at this moment in our galaxy. So how do you do that? Well, the first set of factors in this equation are things that we actually have some knowledge about. So the very first factor is how many stars are formed in a given amount of time in our galaxy. So how many stars are formed, new stars form, come into existence every year? And it turns out that it's of the order of 1 to 2 stars. And that's something that astronomers have been able to pin down. Next, we multiply that by a fraction or a frequency that says, well, how many of those stars build planetary systems around them? Because planets, we think, are important environments to look at in terms of life. And that, too, is actually a number, a quantity we now have some constraints on. I think if you were here yesterday, you heard some discussion of the work being done on so-called exoplanets, and we'll talk more about that as well. We actually have some idea, and the bottom line is every star in our galaxy is likely to have some kind of planetary system about it. And we actually have good enough statistics to make that statement. And the next factor is, well, how many of those planets might resemble the Earth in some way? Might be smallish, rocky planets that could be temperate. And even there, we have some inkling of what that number is. It's somewhere between 10 to 40% of planets, we think. That's only saying that these planets might be about the same size as the Earth. Possibly a similar composition. But then, The next factor is how many of those planets or what the frequency is of abiogenesis. How often does life occur on a seemingly suitable planet? And that's kind of where we hit a brick wall. That's where our knowledge comes to a grinding halt, because we actually have a really hard time saying anything about the frequency with which we expect life to occur in these environments. And I know this is something we want to get a little bit deeper into, these questions of origins of life. And actually, maybe one piece of that is just defining life. I mean, Chris, I think this is true to say that it sounds so simple. So what's life and what's not life? But actually, it's a really difficult question.
Yeah, I agree. So there's long debates about how do you define life. And I don't want to get too much into that because that, you know, there's lots of details that people really care about. For me, what it mostly comes down to is things that are able to replicate, persist, and evolve greater complexity. So much of what we require of life on our own planet is for it to be able to find new niches, find new environments, be able to basically spread, avoid extinction, and find greater functionality and adaptations to particular types of environments. But I also want to say I really agree with Caleb about how hard estimating this probability of the origin of life itself actually is. You know, most of the time that we want to calculate a probability, we have this massive set of data, and we're take some nice average over it. And even in the exoplanet world, we now have enough different types of sets of information that we can calculate really nice averages. For the origins of life, we only have this one event on our own planet, and so it's hard to extrapolate that to think about how likely that is in general. And so a lot of the work then needs to focus on what are the principles or the general principles that lead to something like an origin event. And then you can start to ask, well, where are those conditions likely to be somewhere else? And that also remains a very hard problem because the space of chemistry is both large and complex. And the types of things that we've been able to see in different complicated environments gives us hope that the sort of forming different types of complexity is perhaps easy. And a lot of the focus in this world of chemical origins has focused on autocatalytic cycles, which are just cycles that give rise to more of themselves. That starts to look like replication in a very crude sense. Where you have some cycle that's propagating the cycle into adjacent environments. And a lot of the evolutionary theory that we use today can even be used to think about how different types of chemical systems compete with one another and how those might be selected for in time and perhaps evolve greater complexity. We also know that lots of different types of physical structures can be organized simply from physics. So there's lots of interesting patterns that you can get completely without life, just with simple chemical physical systems. So where you maybe have some chemical that is diffusing in an environment, so that's just the physical process of how random spread occurs, and then also reacting in an interesting way such that these emergent patterns happen. And so this tells us that there's lots of interesting processes that can occur before life that looks sort of similar to life in lots of ways. So that's all good news for starting to uncouple or uncover some of the processes that might allow us to calculate how likely the origination of life is. If we then look at our particular history to try and get a better sense of that probability, there are places where we can be really optimistic and places where we can be really pessimistic. So the optimism is that it looks like it took us about 500 million years to go from no life to something like bacteria after the conditions were right on this planet. So after something like a moon-forming impact, which would have sterilized any life that had existed at that point, we then don't wait very long, only 500 million years, to see a new form of life, or the first form of life. So that makes us fairly optimistic. But what makes us pessimistic is that we then take at least 1 billion years to go from this very simple form of life to something slightly more complicated in the eukaryote, which is just sort of a simple microbial cell with an extra layer of internal architecture is sort of the nicest way to think about it. And that takes much longer than to get life in the first place. So the fact that we go from existing life to slightly more complicated life in a much longer time scale might provide some pessimism in terms of how easy some of these steps are. And so I think this is still a probability that we're uncertain about. But I'm wondering, Caleb, what would change your estimation one way or another about how likely that event is?
Well, I think what's interesting listening to you describe some of our insights to the processes that we think must be involved in giving rise to life as we know it. And again, we still don't have a perfect definition of life, of what's living and what's not living. But one thing that occurs to me is, again, if in the Drake equation, that magic expression where we have the probability of this environment, this planet giving rise to life, all the pieces that you describe have yet to be pulled together into a fundamental theory of life. And I think that's one of the biggest open questions in science right now, that we do not have a first principles fundamental theory of life in the way that we have theories in physics and so on. And that is one route to calculating that probability, to answering the question of whether we're alone or not, but then also reflecting on that in terms of our existence here. But there's another way to do it, right? I mean, there's the first principles calculation that says, this is the probability, and incidentally, I think it's also fair to say we have no idea whether that's a reasonably high probability or an extremely tiny probability for a given planet. That's another question to look into. We don't have the first principles theory to give us an estimate of that probability, but we have another route, which is actually to forget about the details and to go looking for life in the universe. And by looking for life in the universe, if we could count other instances of life across our galaxy, we could then derive from that a constraint on that fundamental probability. Now, you probably need both of these things to really understand the nature of life, but it's kind of interesting to me that I don't know which is going to succeed first, and they're going to ultimately help constrain each other. I mean, maybe this question of just how unlikely life is an interesting one, and it always comes up. Do you have any feelings on that?
Yeah, I wouldn't be able to put a number to it. I mean, I would say my estimation would radically change if we see another even bacterial species somewhere in our own solar system. And that's where a lot of the hunt for astrobiological or exo, beyond our own planets, the search for life in that context is happening, right? We've heard some of about what's happening on Mars and that search right today. And then there's also a search on places like Enceladus, which is an icy moon. And so I think if we saw something else there, obviously that, for me, probably makes the probability 100%. And for at a solar system level, it would put me more on that end of the scale. So, yeah.
Right, yeah. And I think, there's some interesting sort of minutia to this as well, because one way to have the probability of life on a planet be quite high is to have the planet be a complex chemical incubator. A planet is a pretty big place. And while the probability of a particular set of molecules just sort of spontaneously ending up in the right place in the right configuration to give you that first autocatalytic cycle or whatever may be extraordinarily small, the scale of a planet is it's like a Google system, right? It's searching this enormous chemical landscape, but it's doing so many simultaneous searches. It's like a big parallel computation. Do you feel that plays into it? I mean, is it more probable to find life on a larger planet than it is on a small icy moon? I mean, is that... And then that's related to the question of the persistence of life.
Yeah, I mean, I think for me, it's more this question about ability for life to move beyond the place where it starts into other environments, right? So I think a small planet that's incredibly rich in its chemistry and energy flux, where you can get life to start in one place and then propagate across an entire planet, that to me makes persistence and evolutionary complexity much more possible. So that to me is the real question. So if you have an icy moon, it has one really great vent system where there's huge amounts of energy production, it's even possible that in such a great environment, life starts and for reasons of circumstance and happenstance just doesn't happen to make it because it can't propagate into nearby adjacent environments. So I think that's really the question, is how rich is a planet, and also how easy is it for life to sort of start and start to give rise to these feedbacks that make its own persistence more likely.
Right.
And actually, on that topic, you know, we've talked a little bit about searching for life in our own solar system, and I want to switch gears a little bit to thinking about one of the best places to search for life, which is across many solar systems. And this is something from a go-there-and-look perspective that we didn't really think we'd ever be able to do. But now with these new observational techniques that are allowing us to see exoplanetary environments where we can see planets going around other stars and even start to look in the atmospheres of those planets, we now have a much greater sample of environments in which we might be able to look for what we call biosignatures, signatures of life. And so we're more new technology is coming online to give us sort of better resolution of what's in the atmospheres of these other planets. It's something Caleb does a lot of. And I'm just wondering, what do you think is the time scale for getting the type of resolution where we might be able to kind of accurately see a biosignature in another planet?
Yeah, it's a great question. So just to try to summarize it, you know, as you say, we've developed these various techniques for detecting the presence of planets around other stars in the presence of noise, not trains, but other things. So some of those techniques, in fact, the majority of those techniques rely on the effect of the planet on the star, either the gravitational influence of the planet making the star wobble a little bit around its location, or one of the most successful techniques is the so-called transit technique, and it's essentially a miniature eclipse. So just by chance, some exoplanetary systems, the orbits are aligned so that from our point of view, the planet moves between us and the star and diminishes a tiny bit of the light of the star when that happens. And it happens, obviously, once every orbit. So we can use that to deduce the existence of a planet, the orbital period of the planet, and hence how far the planet is from the star, and a constraint on the size of the planet. There's something else we can do with transits, is when the planet is between us and the parent star, if the planet has atmosphere, some of the star light will be filtered through that atmosphere. And by looking at that filtered light, by splitting it into a spectrum, we can actually, in principle, detect the molecules and atoms that compose the atmosphere, that make up the atmosphere. And this is one of the prime techniques that we hope to deploy in order to look for signs of so-called biomarkers. So on Earth, oxygen is a pretty good biomarker. So is something like methane. These are things that are predominantly produced by biology. So we're looking for these atmospheric chemical signatures. Now, when is that going to succeed in terms of looking for life? Well, right now we have a few non-Earth-like planets where this has been done. So giant planets, like more like Jupiter, or so-called super-Earth planets, which are planets somewhere between twice the mass of Earth and about the mass of Neptune. And those seem to fall into two classes, one of which may be more Earth-analog than not. The reason we've been able to make some of those chemical measurements on those planets is they're bigger. And so there's more atmosphere, there's more chance of getting a decent signal using your telescope. What's going to happen in the next few years, we hope in 2020, NASA's going to launch its next really big space telescope, the James Webb Space Telescope called JWST. I won't say how much it costs, $9 billion, due to various cost overruns. It's an extremely ambitious instrument, though, and if it all works, it will be a remarkable instrument. So that's supposed to go up in 2020. It may be within a year or two of that launch that we begin to get some of these measurements of potential Earth analog planets orbiting other stars, where we can sense or look at the spectra of light filtered through the atmosphere and see what the composition is, or put some constraints on the composition. Beyond that, I think within a decade, we ought to be able to say something about these potential life-harboring Earth analog planets, whether any of them show signs that could be consistent with the biosphere. We have discovered as well, and just to, maybe you were going to talk about this as well, that there are things that will trick you. We used to think oxygen, I mentioned oxygen and methane, were perfect biosignatures. The only reason they exist in an atmosphere is something's continually putting them in an atmosphere, and on Earth we know methane and oxygen come from life predominantly. Well, it turns out that that may not be true. In fact, there are non-biological processes that can enrich an atmosphere with oxygen, depending on the chemistry of the rock surface of the planet, and even things like methane become very difficult. So it's going to be interesting, and it's actually going to start happening pretty soon in the next few years.
Yep. Yeah, and I think, I mean, this point about how hard it is to pick a signal that you can prove is not produced by some abiotic process is really very challenging, because it comes down to building entire planetary models, right? And the problem when you build an entire planetary model is that you have all of these different varieties of coupled dynamics, right? So you have this very complicated atmosphere that has these large-scale and small-scale fluid dynamics. You have an ocean that's doing the same thing. You have a particular continental geometry. You have what's happening in the core of the planet and all the volcanic activity. And then if you inject biology into that, you have all of these interesting feedbacks between how the ocean uptakes and releases certain types of chemicals from the atmosphere, for example, oxygen or carbon dioxide. And that's interacting with the fluid and giving rise to these planetary scale processes. And so when you start to couple that many different types of dynamics together, each of which has very complicated physics, very complicated chemistry, then you run into this challenge of being able to invent fairly exotic processes that are without life that will give rise to signatures that look very lifelike. And in a way, that's sort of what we need to get life to start in the first place, is we need something that is purely abiotic that starts to give very complicated types of signatures and almost could fool us that it's lifelike. Otherwise, life couldn't start in the first place. And so I think what's interesting is that a lot of the work that's happening in astrobiology, especially around exoplanets, is intimately connected with the types of planetary ecological models that we build for our own planet. And that's a very nice connection, because it means that all of the ecological thinking that we're deploying to think about the long-term dynamics of our own planet and climate change will allow us to both say things about other exoplanets, but also all the work that happens in this exoplanetary sphere can also tell us something about what we might be missing in the dynamics of our own world. And so I think this is a really, from this interplanetary perspective, a really nice connection between the very far away and the very close types of planetary dynamics.
Yeah, and I just, a couple of things to add to that. You know, so I'm an astrophysicist by training. And the funny thing is, starting to work on planets, is planets are horribly complicated. In astrophysics, you know, stars are simple. We can, you know, figure out the basic functioning of stars with just a few lines of equations and a little bit of physics. Planets are insanely complex. It doesn't matter whether it's a gas giant like Jupiter or a terrestrial-type planet like the Earth. But the interesting thing, as Chris says, that we're so slowly realizing as we do this work, for example, I'm involved in building sophisticated supercomputer models of planetary climate, not for the Earth, but for alien worlds, worlds in different configurations. And what we're realizing is that, again, it's a mirror to us. Out there will be exoplanets, Earth-type planets, that reflect the Earth as it has been in the past and as it will be in the future. Okay, so we may see planets that reflect the Earth as it perhaps was when it was only a billion years old. And that will be extraordinarily interesting, not just from the point of view of studying those worlds, but what we learn about the potential past history of environment on our planet and in the future. I mean, we're always interested in the future, and I think this festival is in most respects about the future, about our future as a species, about the integrated system that we're part of. There may be worlds out there that are Earth 10 billion years in the future, around a different type of star that will live that long. Our sun, unfortunately, is not going to take us that far. In fact, in about a billion years' time, it's all going to be over for life on the surface of the Earth. But yes, it's the complexity is an enormous challenge, but it's also an extraordinary opportunity to learn new things about the functioning of our own world.
Yep. Yeah, and on that note, I would also say that a lot of what I see happens in scientific progress is either we develop some really nice fundamental theories that tell us what kind of the bounding possibilities are in some system, and we often use those to great effect. But another thing that has really pushed our progress in science along is surprising observations, and that usually requires looking at a vast amount of diversity. And so, especially in the biological sciences, I would say that observing forms of life that we didn't think could exist, or observing types of metabolic processes in cells or communities, all told us something about where our thinking was wrong, how diverse life could be, what evolution actually looks like. And so I think it's very exciting to suddenly have this opportunity to see a variety of planets so that we can get surprised and sort of better inform our thinking about where we have it really right about life and planetary dynamics and our own planet, and where we are surprised about what else could be possible. And so I think that's a place where we should be able to make a lot of progress in the next 20 to 50 years. So.
Yeah, absolutely. And to come back to the question of identifying life and biospheres and seeing whether they resemble anything that we know on Earth. And as Chris says, you know, life on Earth is vastly more diverse than we had imagined 20, 30 years ago. I mean, there are crazy, crazy organisms that we're not necessarily used to because they're in environments that we don't inhabit. There are things that have been found deep in South African gold mines, in isolated pockets of water, where actually the root sort of feedstock for their metabolic cycle originates with radioactive decay in the rocks, which actually splits water molecules and produces useful things like hydrogen and oxygen that those organisms gobble up. And without that radioactive decay, they would not be able to survive in those environments. But from the astrobiological perspective, from the exoplanet perspective, you know, we may struggle to look at a single planet and say for sure that that has a biosphere and that it is a biosphere engaged in these sorts of processes. But my suspicion is one way this may play out, and we'll see in the next 10 years, is that we'll find a whole bunch of planets that just look different. That something is going on that set of planets that isn't going on this whole other set of planets that are otherwise very similar. And I think we'll be drawn to the conclusion that life is happening to those planets and not to these other planets. And that will actually be incredibly informative, because then we could immediately start asking what went wrong, what went right, depending on your perspective. I mean, you know, you could see life as the ultimate infestation, and planets may not want to be infested by life, but it definitely changes them significantly.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I think that's actually just about our time. So thank you, Caleb, for participating in this conversation. And
thank you.
This is fun. And thank you for coming today. Yeah.
Question?